On behalf of the Florida chapter of SOCAP, let me welcome everybody to the first of a series of webinars that we are going to be doing on today's technology. This one is titled Welcome to the Future of Customer Service, the four acronyms of the apocalypse, AI, AR, VR, and I.o.T. The plan is to do this high-level look at all of these, and then we will be setting up follow-up webinars, and we'll be addressing, Lon will be addressing, who I'll introduce in a minute, each of these individually. AI, in fact, we have a webinar going to be scheduled for April 1st, and we'll deep dive into each of these along the way, each month. But for those of you who may not be familiar with SOCAP, SOCAP, Society of Consumer Affairs and Business, is a 2,500 member organization made up and dedicated to consumer relations and customer service. And I am Chip Rohde. I am president of the Florida chapter of SOCAP. And one of our efforts is to be able to help professionals in this field learn about new technologies, things that are emerging, looking at ways to potentially incorporate that to enhance the consumer experience. And that's what this is all about, and that is what the next four will be about as well. If you have questions through the presentation, there is a little chat box at the bottom. You can send your question in, and at the end, I will ask the question, and then we'll open your mic up. You can open it up if you have a follow-up to that. So if you could do that, we'll hold the questions till the end as we go through Lon's presentation. So with that, and really no further ado, by the way, this is going to be recorded, I should mention that, and will be available on demand for someone who has not been able to make it, or if you want to share it with somebody. So, as I mentioned, I'm Chip Rohde, who is president of the Florida chapter, and it is my pleasure to introduce Lon Safko, who is our presenter. He is an innovator, inventor, best-selling author. He's an international speaker, trainer, and consultant, and is the creator of what Steve Jobs called the first computer to save a human life. Lon has founded 14 companies and has 18 innovations in the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, D.C., along with 30,000 of his professional papers. He's an author of multiple innovative best-selling books, including one that some of you may have read called The Social Media Bible. It's in its third edition, 5 languages, and is actually breaking 2 million in sales. His most recent book is AI Chatbots, which you'll have an opportunity to download, which is hitting number one on Amazon. Lon works with the world's largest companies on how to harness innovative thinking with social media and digital communications to help create greater productivity and increased consumer satisfaction, as in the area of customer care. It's my pleasure to introduce my good friend and the master at explaining technology and how it can help you, Lon Safko. Lon, you're on.
Holy moly, that's a heck of an intro. Jeez, thank you. I want you to do my eulogy, if you don't mind.
Not for a long time.
Okay, fair enough. Yeah, so hello, welcome everybody. I'm really glad that you came out. I'm glad that you guys are on the cutting edge. Out of every single person we invited, you were the ones that showed up because you were recognizing the importance of this information that we're going to present here today. Back in 2006, 2007, I was running around preaching Web 2.0 and social media, and nobody was listening. Nobody. Everybody said it's a fad, it's for kids, it's for people locked in their own basements. And when I first started working with SOCAP, there was only a few, very few companies that really recognized the value of social media and got on the bandwagon early. And they're the ones with the biggest successes. And now that everybody kind of gets social media, we're at a new threshold here. And I'm telling you, it's the same feeling that I got years before anybody, we didn't even call it social media at the time. I'm getting the same feeling about this because AI, AR, VR, and IoT is going to affect the way you live, the way you do business. And I'm telling you, trust me on this, it's going to significantly affect customer service. Maybe as much, if not more, because of the breadth, the width, and the expanse of this technology. So that's why when I was telling Chip about this and that I make presentations to top executives and associations, he said, you got to come in and talk about this because this is going to affect us. Absolutely correct. This is going to be high level. We're going to go fast. There's going to be a lot of data. So you can watch the video again because it'll be on demand. And you can also download the slides. And you can tell by the speed of my voice that I am significantly caffeinated. So let's just jump in and we're gonna hit it hard. Now, that's my biography. The only reason I put it in there is so that if you want to download it and see some of the crazy stuff that I've done a lot of really fun and crazy stuff. My wife calls me Forrest Gump of technology because I've always been in the most unusual places. But it's pretty extensive, my background. And I leave that in because you can go to lonsafko.com and download these slides and get them in a PDF so you can print them out and you can review them later on. That's why that's in there. Don't try to read it. Your eyes will actually bleed. Now, I also, let's first, before we do anything, let's define what all of these crazy acronyms of the apocalypse. And yes, that's hyperbole. That's tongue in cheek. And I do that on purpose to get everybody's attention because these really are kind of the apocalypse if you don't understand what they are. The first one, AI, and I know you've all heard of that, artificial intelligence. Elon Musk is hiding under his bed because of it. He's terrified of artificial intelligence. A lot of people are. It's not as bad as you think, and I'll demystify that as we go through this presentation. The second one is augmented reality. Augmented reality is totally awesome. It's a brand new technology. I'll explain why here in the next couple of slides. And you're going to see more and more and more of augmented reality in everything that we do, especially the automotive industry. They've really embraced it very fast. Virtual reality. Virtual reality has been around, basically Second Life was around since 2003. One of Chip and myself, he was working for NCO at the time, and we had an executive meeting of the top executives at NCO. And instead of doing it over the phone, over a bridge line, that was the word I was thinking of the other day, Chip. Instead of doing it over a bridge line, I challenged them to enter a virtual reality, a computer-generated environment, and hold this meeting. And it was one of the best executive meetings I've ever had because it was completely different. Now, virtual reality has had its issues. It's kind of softened, but it's coming back with a vengeance, and I'm going to explain why and how it's going to affect you. And then the last one is IoT, Internet of Things, and also really exciting. And Jordan, if you're not watching this presentation, you got to watch this. Every single thing in the kitchen is going to or has already have built into it this Internet of Things capability. And we'll get into each one of these so we can explain. Now, I've got a challenge for any of you techies that are out there. And the first person that can tell me what that is, I'll give a copy of my $30 book, The Innovative Thinking Bible. So I'm just going to pause for a second. That has a name. And tell me what that is. And you can put it in the chat. Or if you're doing it on demand, then be the first one on demand to put it in the chat. And the reason I put that in there is if you know what that is, you'll realize there's nothing to be afraid of when it comes to artificial intelligence. So I just want to give myself just a little bit of credibility on each of these subjects because they are extremely cutting edge. And you got to ask, how does somebody go from social media into these types of in-depth technologies? Well, my background is an engineer. And oh, good. We got something in the chat. That's cool. Chip, if you can take a peek at that. As an engineer and then a computer programmer, and then I spent most of my career in marketing. So I've always been about technology used for marketing, customer service, and sales. So what happened was, in 1987, I was actually asked by the United States Department of Energy to come and develop what turned out to be the world's first artificial intelligence computer program to track nuclear products, nuclear byproducts, and nuclear waste at the Hanford nuclear reservation in Washington State. They saw me on the Today Show, and they basically, we're the government, and we're going to make you an offer that you can't refuse. And in 1987, I believe it was spring, maybe March, we produced the first artificial intelligent computer program for nuclear materials. So I know a little bit about AI, going all the way back to 87. Now, if you want to go back a little bit further, I had one of the first computers, the Apple and Timex Sinclair and Franklin and a bunch of them. I was always into technology. And if you're looking at this, I know you can't read it, but that's the actual first page of code that I wrote when I created, didn't realize it at the time, the world's first chatbot, so that you can talk to it and it can talk back to you. And it was actually what they call a deep learning chatbot, because the more you used it, the more it actually, the better it got, which was kind of cool. And then that actually evolved into my creating the first commercially available voice recognition, which became Dragon Dictate, and now it's Siri, and voice recognition, which is also part of voice synthesizing. And that then turned into, in 1985, the first computer to save a human life. It was called Sensei. So there's some more AI. And then for virtual reality, I got a chance to meet the actual inventor of virtual reality, Thomas Furness, at the University of Washington. And he asked, summoned me to U of Dub, because he had been working on virtual reality for more than a decade at the Wright-Patterson Air Force Base. And my system, according to what he said, had all the exact same components, and it was commercially available for $2,500, where they had just spent over $5 billion creating almost the same system. And we had a really great afternoon. So as far as virtual reality, I've got an extensive background. Now, Internet of Things didn't exist until recently, because I was on the Internet in 1994, which was pretty early. But the actual Internet of Things didn't exist at all. But I created my own internet inside of a house where this system could, you can say, lamp on, lamp off, television up, lock front door, call mom, and it would all connect inside of a house, up to 255 appliances. And that's when I began working with the physically disabled, because all of what you see here actually saved physically disabled's life. Matter of fact, Christopher Reeve, Superman, was my last customer that I had personally worked with before I left the company. So here is something that's going to be astonishing to you, is customer service. This is the face of customer service. Well, actually, this is the face of my little puppy. Her name is Bella, but she has done some amazing things. Now, this is the chatbot, the AI, not the dog necessarily, has done absolutely amazing things on the websites that I've installed it on. And we'll talk more about that, but I just want to introduce you.
Hi, my name is Bella. How can I help you?
This is the face of customer service. What we're going to talk about, AI and chatbots, changed my customer service more in the first 30 days than in my entire career. And it's going to do the same for all of you, honestly. So let's get into each and define what they are. Now, I'm going to go a little bit out of order because of the way they're structured. The Internet of Things is an overarching, high-level kind of a technology that is going to incorporate a lot of artificial intelligence, some AR, some VR. So I want to start with this because it's the kind of overarching technology. Now, let me explain. Don't be concerned about any of this stuff. It's like everything else. If you don't understand it, it's going to scare you a little bit. But as soon as you understand it, it's not hard at all. Internet of Things just means that everything is going to have some kind of a chip in it that's going to allow it to use Wi-Fi and the internet to intercommunicate either with you or other devices. That's all there is to it. Devices that can communicate with you or other devices using the internet. Internet of Things. But now, the best way to explain this and get you to understand is to give you some examples of what Internet of Things are. Everybody recognizes that picture that's up there. That's a doorbell. It costs about $2 at a hardware store or a big box home center, about $2. And if 5 or 6 years ago I came to you and I said, hey, you and I have been friends for a while. I need to borrow $500,000 because I'm going to build a new doorbell. And you said, a new doorbell? Are you kidding me? Why? I said, well, the cool thing is it's only $200. You would have laughed at me. Why would anybody put a $200 doorbell on their house when they already have a $2 doorbell? Well, we saw what happened. Ring happened. Now, Internet of Things. We have a doorbell now that, first of all, has artificial intelligence because it can sense when somebody is approaching the door. It knows how to adjust for the light. It knows how to capture audio, knows how to capture video, knows how to connect to the internet via Wi-Fi. And even better than that, anywhere you are on Earth, it will then connect with your smartphone and show you who's at the door and allow you to communicate back and forth. That's Internet of Things. So you see how simple it is, but it has far-reaching implications, and it's going to affect us and customer service in profound ways. So let's take a look at something else. Thermostat. Probably most of our homes right now today have this type of old $10 thermostat. It's kind of standard, has a little mercury tube in there. It's not digital. It's tips back and forth based on the heat. And everybody said, why would you upgrade a $10 thermostat to something that costs close to $100? Well, because you have Nest. Nest changed the heating industry. It has a motion sensor, so it knows when you're home and when you're not home. It will keep track of the patterns. So it knows that if every day you leave for work at 7:30 in the morning, it knows 7:30, I'm just going to turn the heat down or turn the air conditioner up. It automatically takes that into consideration. But it also connects through the internet so that if you're driving home from work and it's on a particularly cold night, you may want to turn the heat on about an hour early. The other thing is it will monitor all of your kilowatt hours so that you can hopefully reduce some of the cost of heating and air conditioning if you use electricity. The other thing that it does, especially here in California, we have what's called smart meters, and the smart meters will actually talk to the Nest. I know it's kind of weird, right? Our electric meter will talk to our thermostat and say, hey, wait a minute. The thermostat says, nobody's home, but I should put on the air conditioner because it's warming up a little bit. The meter will say, no, you're in prime kilowatt hours. Your owner is going to pay the most for those kilowatt because it's prime time. Why don't you just wait until like an hour before they come home before you start to cool the house when the electric rates are cheaper? I want you to comprehend that for a second. That's Internet of Things. And you know that customer service is going to have to deal with this on levels that is incomprehensible at this point. So, but look at what it saves and look at where we're headed with this type of technology. And now we remember Bubba looking at your car to diagnose what the problem is because you said it goes click, click, sis, sis, boom, and he can't find it because he's looking through hungover, bloodshot eyes from the previous night on your 1978 Ford Torino. Well, we've come a long way since then, and Chip shared a story with me the other day where his car was starting sluggishly, and it's a brand new car, and he didn't know why, and it shouldn't do that. So he brought it into the dealer. The dealer plugged in a small little box into the dashboard of the car and said, come on into the office. And 8 minutes later, he says, okay, he says, your car is done. And Chip is like, car is done for what? Well, what had happened was that box did a complete analysis on everything in the computer, the history of what the car had done. It found an error that the artificial intelligence had found on several other exact same models, brought it to the engineer's attention. The engineer reprogrammed that, and within just a few minutes, the entire software program for the car was downloaded through that box, through the internet, and put into the car. So all they had to do is pull the box out, and Chip drove away home with a perfectly updated car. Now, is that changing customer service or not? I mean, the things that we're going to be doing with this technology, we don't even know yet, but that's the power of just Internet of Things. Imagine completely updating a car in just a few minutes so that it now runs perfectly, all automatically. Now, here's what's making all of this possible. This is the driving force. Not this old yellow kitchen telephone. No, but when we went from that to this, this is what's making it possible. We have more computing power in that little box than NASA had in Apollo 11 to put the men on the moon. This is unbelievable technology, and this is going to be the core of what's going to drive the Internet of Things. Now, I'm not going to go through all of this, but Chevrolet, let's hear it for Chevrolet. They were one of the first out there that created an app that interfaced directly with the car. So if you have your smartphone with you and you want to lock or unlock the door for somebody, or if you don't know where your car is in the parking lot, which, by the way, happened to me at Costco the other day, and I'm afraid to even admit that. It took me a while to find it, but I found it. I didn't have one of these apps. And then the other thing is, in the morning, it will say, "Hi, good morning. I'm your Chevy. I'm sitting out in the driveway. Your left front tire is about 2 pounds low, but don't worry about it. You can wait until the weekend to get that fixed. And your oil has about 80% life, so you're good on that. That's also fine." And it will give you a complete diagnostic of your car before you even leave the house. You have about a quarter of a tank of gas, and based on the mileage that you've been using, you can get to and from work fine. Fill that up on Saturday morning. Could you imagine how smart all of these devices are? And that is primarily the Internet of Things, things connected through the internet, but also the embedded artificial intelligence. Now, again, if you think that I'm making this up, or I'm just a techie and I'm all excited about this, which I happen to be, but remember, I am marketing and customer service. That's my primary goal. Here's some of the companies, hundreds of companies, and not small companies. These aren't kids in the basement. These are Google, Amazon, Microsoft, the biggest companies on earth, are dumping billions into Internet of Things, artificial intelligence, augmented reality. So is it mainstream? Is Internet of Things mainstream? I mean, is there any reason that we should believe that the Internet of Things is infiltrating our lives? If you watch the Super Bowl, the 2020 Super Bowl, it was a Budweiser commercial. And by the way, this is the first time in history that two companies actually worked together, collaborated on a commercial. And this one happened to be Budweiser and Uber. And I can understand why they might want to share the cost at $5 million for a 30-second play. So, but I want you to watch this.
Hey, what's up?
Not much. Wishing I was watching the game, having a bud. What's up with you?
Like you, wishing I was watching the game, having a bud.
True. True.
What's up?
What's up?
What's up?
What's up?
Yo, where's D-Unit?
What's up?
What's up?
It's a smart world. Don't be stupid about how you get around tonight. Use Uber promo code WhatsUp to help get home after the game. Must be legal drinking age.
That was close.
True. True.
Now, come on. Is that hysterical? I mean, first of all, it's funny. Budweiser is not a high-tech company. They're clients are not necessarily high-tech type people, but they felt that the Internet of Things was enough to get your attention, and it's already embedded in our life, our lifestyle, that people would relate to it. Because remember, if you can't relate to the Internet of Things, that commercial would have no meaning. So subconsciously, even though you're not aware of it, you are aware of it. So, and I need to bring it to your consciousness. The more you're aware of it, the more you can anticipate it, and the more you can figure out how to learn it to your advantage. So let's go on to the next one, because we talked a lot about artificial intelligence. I've always loved artificial intelligence. Again, I've been programming it since 1978. AI scares everybody. By the way, again, Elon Musk and some really brilliant people are afraid of AI. We're not going to have Skynet. Skynet, if you're a Terminator fan, is where the AI took over from the satellites and felt that man was a threat and felt that they should extinguish man. That's not going to happen. Here's what AI is. It's some code, which is some sentences, lines of code, that simply helps us do things that we can't normally do because there's just too much data or we can't do it fast enough. AI now is being used to look at mammograms, and it has almost 100% success rate, where doctors are somewhere down, even professional doctors, that's all they do, they're specialists, they're down around 92% success rate. You know what? If I'm a woman and I got a mammogram, I want the computer's AI to look at it and give me 100% rather than have an expert doctor look at it. Yeah. So It's all around us. But remember, it's just a set of rules. If this, then that. Computer programmers call that an if-then statement. And we're just putting it in different places because we don't have the ability to look through the massive amounts of information that we're collecting now and identify patterns. And that's primarily what it is. And at any time we don't like how AI is behaving, yes, we can pull the plug. You reach over and you pull the plug, just like you can on your laptop, desktop, or shut off your phone. But let me give you some examples of how it's around us. You know, we've seen Sophia, the woman robot. She was granted, I forgot what country it was, but she was granted citizenship, the first robot ever to get citizenship in a country. That's absolutely amazing. Robots have been around since the 70s. We saw a huge change in the automotive industry where computers actually were running robotics that were building our cars to perfection. The quality increased. I mean, it was just absolutely amazing. So robots have been around forever. We're not afraid of them. And they're getting better. Absolutely stunning how better they're getting. The Tesla, the new cars, they were self-driving. Tesla was just tested, and it was tested as one of the best self-driving cars in America right now. And basically, what we're going to see in our lifetime, you're going to get in the car in the morning, and you're going to say to your car, drive me to work. And you're going to put the seat all the way back, and you're going to get your cup of coffee, and you're going to watch the scenery, because the car is going to take you from your garage to your parking space at your job. And it's going to do it more safely, and that's the key, more safely than you can drive yourself. And that's what these recent reports have just proven. So yes, that's going to affect us. And even Pandora. Pandora actually takes hundreds of thousands of songs. They have tens of thousands of engineers. They take every song and they test 400 different criteria on every piece of music. So that when you say, I want to listen to Marvin Gaye, and they play some, but then they play other artists, and you say, wow, you know, I didn't realize that they're remarkably similar. Well, they are, because AI tested every song on earth and found these 400 criteria that matches closely to Marvin Gaye's criteria. And that's how they do it. That's artificial intelligence. Netflix. Hey, if you watch this show, man, you're going to totally love this one. Okay, Netflix doesn't have their AI quite where it needs to be. It's kind of artificial special ed, but it's getting there. It's not bad. And Amazon does the same thing. Hey, if you bought this, other customers have bought this, have also bought this, 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 and this. Artificial intelligence. And we're also seeing it in Siri. It's built into all of our phones. And we'll see it in Alexa and Google. It's all around us. You're just maybe not so aware that everything right now has this foundation of artificial intelligence. Now, one type of artificial intelligence is chatbots. Now, the reason I'm going to just take a second and explain this, and even though that my company is a small company, it's not a Fortune 500 or Fortune 1000. When I hated chatbots. I thought they were intrusive and they were annoying, but I knew they were coming. So a year ago, I studied every chatbot that I can find, and I found one that I really liked, and I installed it on my educational product site. It's at the bottom, Paper Models Online. So if you want to see how a chatbot works, a good one, and interact with it, you can go to Paper Models Online. And I installed it, and I worked with it. I'm telling you, I was so shocked of the positive consequences that came out of this that I actually wrote a book, put it on Amazon, and within 3 days, it hit number one in three business categories and stayed there for more than a week. It also got me to contact the developer, and him and I have been working together on that chatbot for a year. It's unbelievable. Keeping people on your website is the toughest thing, even especially when it comes to customer service, because they're already angry and frustrated, and they don't want to have to look around, go through pull-down menus, or dial 800 numbers, or whatever you, even chat, live chat. Do you want to pay for live chat? Do you want to have hundreds of people manning it? Don't have to. So with the chatbot that I put on there, the average time a person stays on a website is 10 to 15 seconds. I had people conversing with this chatbot for up to 25 minutes. And at the end of every one of these conversations, it led to a sale. They won't use contact forms. I found out. They told my chatbot they'll never use a corporate contact form because they know that's how we capture their email addresses for spam lists. Never could figure out why they had questions but never used the contact form. My chatbot told me this. Coupons. What I realize is that about 1 out of 10 people will only pull the trigger on that mark, that buying decision, if they think they're getting a deal. They have to have a coupon. But I'm not going to give everybody a coupon because that's just leaving money on the table. So I hide a coupon so nobody can find it. But if the customer asks for that coupon, the chatbot knows where it is and gives the customer a 10% off discount 100% of the time within minutes. That sale is closed. And it goes all the way through. Frequently asked questions. There were questions I didn't even know they were asking that the chatbot was discovering. I put it in my frequently asked page. And within 24 hours, the chatbot now could answer those questions. The customers are happy and it resulted in a sale. Net, net, a well-designed chatbot. And that's the key, a well-designed. Don't get a chatbot that was designed by geeks. They're awesome because it'll work great as code. But it will not work great because it doesn't understand the psychology of working with people the way you and I do. So that's the key. And that's the hardest part to find. So what happened was, and here's the grand payoff. I'm not going to go through all of these, but if you have any questions, feel free to contact me. And I'm glad to share it. And at the end, I'll even give you this book, this number one best-selling book. What happened was, is at the end of the first 30 days, I saw a 30% increase in sales. Now, I know you guys aren't sales. But you got to appreciate a 30% increase. Why? Because the customer service questions were being answered immediately, and that caused them to buy. And it's been on my website for a year, and every single month for the last year, I've seen a 30% increase in revenue. Overall, unbelievable. So I went from hating chatbots to writing a best-selling book. And the subtitle is Unexpected Positive Consequences. Because until you actually see it in operation, you don't have any idea. Now, I want to give you one more example of artificial intelligence. Here it comes. This is kind of fun. This also was a 2020 Super Bowl commercial. It's called SmartPoc. And if you've ever been to Boston, you'll see these actors got that accent nailed.
Oh, look at this guy. Hey, Rachel, how are you?
Hey, good. How are you?
He's not getting that car in there.
No, sir.
Look at these two troublemakers.
Hey, Johnny, how are you?
Wicked car. Is that new?
Yeah, it's a Sonata. Let me pack it.
Oh, you're not fitting your car in there.
Chris, stop being a smarty pants, all right? Look who's got SmartPak.
SmartPak?
Just hit the clicker, car packs itself.
It's smart.
It's wicked smart. And I can pack it anywhere.
How about Dorchester?
Packed it.
Foxborough?
Packed it.
The Garden?
Packed it.
Saugus?
Packed it.
Swampscott?
Revere?
The Harbor?
Are you kidding me? I packed it and then unpacked it.
You unpacked it?
Kid.
Game changer.
That Sonata ain't got no driver.
That's all right. He's got SmartPak.
Hey, look at him back there.
He's got SmartPak!
Hey, whoa, it's Big Poppy.
Wicked smart.
This is a ghost car.
A better way to park. Only available on the all-new Sonata with remote smart parking assist.
Sorry about that, your bigness.
Did you guys know he lived there?
I had no idea.
Artificial intelligence. How else can a car do that? And we're seeing that in more and more automobiles. Mercedes, BMW, Honda, across the entire industry. And we're going to see more and more of that as time goes on. Okay, that was artificial intelligence. Now, augmented reality. This is now where it gets a little sketchy. Most people have never even heard of it. Now, you probably heard of an example of Pokemon Go, where people were using their smartphone and they would see this little Pokemon critter and they would run out in front of buses and cars. And yeah, it wasn't a good application of it. But there's a lot of really powerful applications. Augmented reality simply means that you take reality and you augment it. How about that for a wise guy answer? You augment it with valuable information. Now, for example, the reason augmented reality hadn't existed until just recently is we had no way to capture reality. Now, with a smartphone camera, you can. You can hold it up and just move it around, and you are literally capturing reality. But with this artificial intelligence, we now have the ability to augment that reality with useful information. And the image that I'm showing you right here is a downtown street. And simply by taking out your camera and holding it down the street, you can find coffee shops, restaurants, dry cleaners, whatever you're looking for. And it even has the Yelp reviews underneath it. And if you click on it, you can go to their website or you can go to Yelp. It's all 100% interactive. But the most important thing is that this helpful, useful data is being superimposed on top of our reality. And that's what we're going to see the biggest breakthrough here coming up really soon. BMW has this incredible augmented reality where when you're driving down the road, speed signs, speed limits, restaurants, reviews, gas stations, everything is being superimposed on your on-screen dashboard screen. But we can also use it for playing games and helping with products, looking at products three-dimensionally for education. But I know that that's not what you guys are necessarily interested in. Now, in the research that I did for this presentation, I got to say there was one company that stood out, and that was Lowe's Innovation Lab. Now, I never would have thought that a big box home center would be on a cutting edge of augmented reality. I mean, it really surprised me. But I want to show you a couple of videos of just what Lowe's is doing. Now, you're going to say, oh, that's all techie and it's about sales and marketing. No. This is about customer service, because if the customers don't get their questions answered, the sales don't happen. Now, here, let me show you these short videos. Now, what was that? Was that marketing? Was it sales? Or was it customer service? If a customer could walk into a Lowe's, simply put on a pair of goggles, and just by clicking their finger, see all the different type of styles that they can then see in their kitchen or see in what appears to be real life, augmented over top of the reality, and it helps them to purchase, but it makes them a happy customer and answers all of their questions. Oh, do you see where we're going? We're blending the lines again between sales, customer service, and marketing again, the same as we did with social media. This is going to blend those lines, but it also means that we're still responsible. Now, here's another video. You can test out. People were afraid to use trimmers, so you can actually use them, see what it's like. You want to see a piece of furniture that Lowe's sells? Spin it around. Look at it from all the different sides. You're trying to find a product? That's the toughest thing. Look at that. It's a product finder. Is that customer service? I mean, unbelievable. And then they show this kitchen thing again. Now, let me show you this one other. Oh, this I love. Wearing the goggles, you can walk around your room and look at all the furniture that Lowe's sells, and you can place it in your room where you want it to see how it goes with the rest of your furniture before you ever leave your house to go purchase it. Customer service. Oh my gosh, look at this. And then, of course, you can take each one of those pieces of furniture and you can turn it around and look at it, inspect it from every single angle so you know exactly what you're buying. A couple years ago, we didn't have anything like that. Now, this is totally mainstream. And in the case of looking at the products three-dimensionally, modeling, you don't need any glasses, goggles, anything special, not even a special app. Now, here's another one that I just want to show you. A couple of years ago with my granddaughter, we were doing this. It's a coloring book. You color it any way you want. My granddaughter sat down and played with it, and she picked up her iPad, held it over the thing, over the color, and the characters came alive. What she did was a dragon, and the dragon flew out of the book and started flying around the room, colored exactly the way she colored it. Now, what I want you to now do is imagine a schematic of a piece of equipment. So that you can turn it around, zoom in, look at the individual pieces, find the part numbers. Yeah. Okay, let me give you another one here. We'll be right back. Don't just buy our product, experience it. I want you to think about that as a customer service rep. Don't just buy our product, I want you to experience it. What if with those wine labels, and we're only talking about wine, but it can be applied to any product on earth. What if it also had information about the wine, how many awards it won, whether or not it contains sulfates. Sulfates can be really, really bad headaches. And I check every label to make sure that it's on there. And if it's not on there, I don't buy the product. Or I'll have to call the company to find that type of information out. What if those labels actually gave you all of the customer most frequently asked questions and explained it in a really exciting way? These labels came alive, and it doesn't have to just be wine. It can be anything. Okay, we're closing in on the end here. Virtual reality. Virtual reality has been a favorite of mine. I'm very heavy into Second Life. Second Life came out in 2003. It was the biggest. It was the first. And I had probably put in more than 1,000 hours participating, building, creating in virtual reality. I own a home, by the way. Yes, I do. It's a beautiful beach home. Nice two-story home. It's in Second Life, even to this day. And I've been in there since 2007. And I interact with people all over the world. And I'll explain that in a second. But virtual reality is nothing more than a computer creating a reality, kind of like first-person shooter games that you've seen, where people are going around with guns. The thing is that computers now are running so fast, and they're so sophisticated, and the programming is so incredible that we're almost at a point where we can't tell the difference between an artificial environment and a computer-generated environment. Now, the difference is that there's no reality here. It's not like using your smartphone. Everything is created by the computer. Now, the difference between running a virtual reality platform and a first-person shooter, generally those avatars are created by computers. But in this case, virtual reality, every person, every avatar, every critter that you see is actually just another person just like you. So short definition, it's just a computer-generated environment that you can interact with three-dimensionally, which if you haven't done that, again, Chip and I, we did that, I think it was back in 2011. That's how far we go back. And this is the property. Now, that was my avatar then, a little cartoony, but kind of looked like me. I gave it the same hairstyle, the shirt, the pants, and even that was my Jerry Garcia tie. That was my favorite tie, and my avatar wore it. And if you look in the back, that was my property. It was a two-story building on the ground floor. I had two e-commerce online stores in a virtual world. So you can go in, look at virtual products, representations of real products, put in your credit card, which is a virtual form of payment. And guess what? A couple of days later, or if it was a download, immediately your product would be delivered and it was all done virtually. There's a TV screen, a big giant 10-foot TV screen in the back, in the center, in the courtyard. I would teach college classes from all over the world. I would taught at the Indian School of Business. I taught at the Lyon College in Zurich. All the classes were taught there. I can do PowerPoints. Matter of fact, if you go to Second Life, Lon Safko graduation, you can see I had two graduating class ceremonies. We had guest speakers and we gave out diplomas and everybody was wearing robes. Totally incredible. And then on the second floor, I had a conference room where I held executive meetings, like the one I held with Skip and two of the executives from NCO. So again, if this is coming back, how incredible would it be to have a property like this where people can go in and interact either with artificial intelligent customer service reps or for second tier live? I mean, okay, I know, I'm still caffeinated. Okay. Just mention this real quick. That's me interviewing the CEO of Linden Labs. And coincidentally, right after that, I showed up on CNN Headline News. Turned out to be the first executive interview ever to take place in the virtual world. And they made me a CNN reporter, which was cool. But you could do other things. Like on the bottom, I worked with the American Cancer Society. And the event that we held inside of Second Life actually raised $3.5 million real dollars for cancer research for ACS. And at one point, there was actually 252 of the Fortune 500 companies had a presence in Second Life. Now, here's some of the top platforms. Not important, not going to go through them, but these are the biggest ones. If there's 25 of anything, that means that it's here. It's established. And if you want to read them, when you get, go get the slides, lonsafko.com. You'll see the instructions here at the end, and you can read them. But I just want to let you know that this is not just me. This is real. And it's so real that Amazon is literally dumping hundreds of millions of dollars, primarily for customer service. I want that to sink in. Amazon believes that virtual reality is going to be such a plus, sales, marketing, and customer service, that they've have a program called Sumerian, where you can go in, create an avatar, you, your little character, you could teach, as you see in the lower right, like doctors, or you can actually do customer service, like you see this theater over on the left. If you're an automotive company, my brother was sales manager for Honda for almost 20 years, and every Wednesday he would do a new car clinic. What if you held your new car clinic here in an auditorium like this, and then people never had to leave their home? They did it all from their smartphone. I mean, think about the implications. Amazon has already thought about it, and they think it's a multi-hundred million dollar idea. It's not going away, it's getting better. Now, the biggest problem that we had, the barrier to entry, was these glasses and whatever. I'm gonna challenge you, here's a challenge. I'm gonna say it again, this is a challenge. I want you to go to the Google store and I want you to buy Google Cardboard for 15 bucks. It's only $15, but I promise, I absolutely promise you, I got mine right here, that you've never seen anything like this in your life. It's only 15 bucks, it comes with different apps, you can get stuff on YouTube, and when you hold that up and you can go 365 degrees and interact with these virtual environments. Oh, and by the way, we're not just making this up. Progressive Insurance has something called the Lake Dash, Nippon Airways, Samsung, Oreo. You can go into this environment where it's kind of like the Keebler elves, these little elf things are building Oreo cookies, and you can go into this factory. But the thing is, you can look 360 degrees up, down, and interact. Volvo, Patron, IKEA, Merrill, American Express. These companies believe in virtual reality. So if your company doesn't, you got to ask why. And it's going to happen soon. Okay, let's wrap this up. Future customer service. I made up this scenario just for this presentation because I wanted to show you where we're going to be next. Suppose you own a hotel chain, a big hotel chain, and I got my smartphone and I log on and I want to book a room. So I log on and then all of a sudden I see the lobby, but in virtual reality, I mean augmented reality. So as I move it around, I can see the lobby 360 degrees. And then suddenly to one side, somebody walks up. Now, this is not animated because I only just did it for this presentation, but it can be animated really well, almost photo quality-like, but just bear with me.
Greetings. Let me welcome you to our hotel, Mr. Safko.
Already know who I am because I'm logged in. She's using voice synthesizing and artificial intelligence to communicate with me.
We are happy to have you stay with us. Please follow me and I will show you to your room.
Not a room, not just a room, not a photograph of a room, but the actual room that they're going to put me in. And again, I'm moving around 360 degrees. I can actually see the room.
This room has two queen-size beds and an ocean view as you requested. If this is to your liking, Mr. Safko, I will gladly book it for the dates you requested.
Yes, this is very nice. Please book this.
I talk to my phone. The phone uses voice recognition. It translates it into text. The text then goes to the artificial intelligence chatbot.
Thank you. Your confirmation will be sent directly to your email. We look forward to serving you soon, and please, let me know if there is anything else I can do to help you.
I just want you to think about this. Just ponder this. Could you imagine booking a hotel this way than using something stupid like Travelocity? Actually having somebody there 24 hours a day. But keep in mind, this is all artificial intelligence. Once you set it up, there's no cost. I'm going to say this again. Once you set this up, you have no cost to customer service for this tier one level. You don't have anybody on the phones. It's all done through artificial intelligence. And the customer gets to see the lobby of the hotel, can see the restaurant, can see the actual room that they're booking. And it's all done through voice recognition. And it's not that far-fetched.
Thank you for your time today. Let's open this up for Q&A.
Okay, let's wrap this up. Now, is your brain full? That's what I want to know.
Okay, Lon, can you hear me okay?
I can, sir.
Okay, we had one response as to who, and that was a retina, it just disappeared, yeah. Retina scanner, if I got that right.
Oh, retina scanner.
Retina scanner from Ray.
Yeah. That's also being incorporated. Hey, right okay. there?
So that was the only answer I got.
Okay, yeah, retina scanner. What that is, there's a little laser, a low wattage laser built into a pair of glasses or goggles that bounces off of the back of your eye, your retina, and it can tell the angle of your eyes so that it knows exactly where on the screen that you're looking. I was using that back in the late 80s to help quadriplegics because they couldn't move anything from their neck down. And we were able to control the computer just by moving the eye. And we've even used that to identify weaknesses with people's websites. Where do people look first? How long do they look at it? Where do they look second?
So what is the answer? What was that object?
The goggles that were in there, Oculus, is one of the higher end virtual reality goggles. What it does is it provides two separate images taken from slightly different angles so that it tricks the brain into making you think that it's actually three-dimensional. So the entire environment, the avatars, the people that you're interacting with, the environment that you're interacting with is so realistically three-dimensional, it's amazing. But what it is, basically, it's just two cameras at the same time from a slightly different angle. And that's what the Google Cardboard does. How that works is you just stick your iPhone in there and run this app, and it has two separate images with these glasses that are built in. And by moving your head around, the iPhone knows how you move your head and changes the position of everything to interact with.
That's amazing. We just got a couple minutes left. Have you unmuted the phones there? If anybody does, I have one question here, but if anybody would like to ask a question of Lon, go ahead.
I got everybody unmuted.
Anybody?
Time. This is free consulting.
No problem. So in the intent of this session is to pique your interest on technology. And if we have given you even some thinking about what it is and how it might apply, at least to begin, then we've been successful. So let's go to chatbot just for a second. So how would you define chatbot? Just in a couple words or less as you look at customer service.
You know, for the novice, you would say that it's intrusive and it's terrible because it's a terrible chatbot. That's why. Well-designed chatbots, again, is absolutely unbelievable. I've run my e-commerce store, the one that I use as an example, for 20 continuous years. Does anybody here know anybody else who's had an e-commerce web-based store running continuously for 20 years? I thought I knew my customers. I thought I knew every question that they could ask. I was a smarty pants. The first week that chatbot was on there, I found more than a dozen questions that my customers were asking. I had no idea, no comprehension that they were important. And simply by putting them into the frequently asked questions, what happened is this particular chatbot does the same thing that Google does. It indexes your website and all of its pages every 24 hours. So that night, it indexed everything, saw the paragraph, the answer to the question that the customer had. And then I was watching. The very next morning, another customer asked the same question. Chatbot says, well, yes, here's the answer to that, and explains it. And within minutes, it closed the sale. And that's how I got the 30% increase.
So that bot can handle those simple tier one type questions easily and continue to learn. That's fantastic.
Yeah, I believe it.
We are just out of time. And one, I want to thank everybody for your time, your interest. We hope this was helpful. Our next webinar is going to be on April 1st. You'll see an announcement at 2:00. And we will dive even deeper into artificial intelligence.
Yeah.
Lon's contact information was up there if you want to follow up with him. More importantly, thank you
all. What's happening?
And have a great day. Thank you much.
Thank you.